China will release its 13th five-year plan on education this year to deepen reform and promote the modernization of education. The National Development and Reform Commission says non-governmental sectors will be encouraged to invest in education.
Dear friends from the press, good afternoon. Welcome to the press conference of the fourth session of the 12th CPPCC. The theme of this press conference is the reform and development of the educational sector. Today we are very happy to have the Education Minister, Mr. Yang Guiren, to sit with us and take your questions. Now let's give the floor to Mr. Yuan. Good afternoon. To start with, I would like to take this precious opportunity to extend my welcome to dear friends from the press, from both home and abroad. I want to thank you for your long-term interest and support, as well as assistance for our education-related work. And thank you also for participating in today's event. I'm very happy to sit with you, compare notes, and answer questions that you're interested in. Thank you. Now the floor is open for questions.
谢谢主持人，我是经济日报中国经济网记者。去年是教育规划纲要颁布实施五周年，有机构发布报告称，我国的教育水平已进入世界中上行列。请问袁部长，这个判断的依据是什么？另外，今年的政府工作报告提出对家庭贫困学生率先免除普通高中学杂费，那么请问未来我国的义务教育是否会进一步延长？谢谢。
With Economic Daily, last year marked the 5th anniversary of the outline of China's national plan for medium and long-term education reform and development. According to some institutions, China's education has entered the medium-high level in the world. What is the basis of that conclusion? And I also have another question. In this year's work report of the government, it is pointed out that students from the rural areas will be the first to be exempted from tuitions and miscellaneous fees for their secondary education. Does that mean that the compulsory free education will be prolonged in China in the future?
Thank you for your question. You asked two questions, actually, which are indeed of very critical importance and are mutually closely linked. We can see that in terms of education, you have a very profound understanding. First, I'll address your first question about the overall development of education in China. As you put it, in 2015, it has been 5 years since the implementation of the mid to long-term plan, and it's also the last year of the 12th five-year plan. At this very critical juncture, we invite independent third parties to evaluate China's educational development. And the main conclusion from this evaluation is that the overall educational development in China is already among the ranks of mid to high levels around the world. According to the evaluation report, the basis for this conclusion is as follows. First, in terms of preschooling, gross enrollment ratio stands at 75%, reaching the average level of mid to high income countries around the world. Second, in terms of the net enrollment ratio in primary schools, that figure is 99.9%. The gross enrollment ratio at middle school is 104%.
中国1.5亿9年义务教育学生的普及率超过
The popularization ratio of Chinese compulsory education for 150 million students is above the average level of high-income countries around the world. The gross enrollment ratio for high school students is 87%. The gross enrollment ratio for higher education institutions is 40%. These two figures are above the average level of mid to high income countries. We all know that China is a developing country with a very big population. Securing such development levels and results was indeed an arduous task. China's educational levels have already entered a new phase of development. Second, as asked by the journalist and reported by the media, some provinces launched exemptions in terms of tuition fees. Does it mean that China is going to prolong the duration of compulsory education? With respect to this, I have two comments to make. When we were investigating the 13th Five-Year Plan, we convened experts to conduct feasibility studies and calculations. Through the decision-making process of the Central Committee and consultations with people from all walks of life during the 13th Five-Year Plan, China's compulsory education will still be 9 years. My second comment is that we are expanding the content of the compulsory education, and we will not prolong the duration of compulsory education during the 13th Five-Year Plan, but we will also take measures to promote educational development, to strive towards the prolonging of the duration of compulsory education in the future. This has to do with the critical elements of compulsory education. Compulsory education, according to the public research, involves at least four major elements. First, popularization. Second, free of charge. Third, equity. Fourth, compulsory. Compulsory education is a basic institutional arrangement of a country. One single country cannot have several compulsory education approaches at the same time. We decided not to prolong the 9-year compulsory education. But in the meantime, we are promoting development of the four aspects that I just mentioned. For example, in terms of popularization, the draft 13th Five-Year Plan and the government work report clearly state that during the 13th Five-Year Plan, we will popularize the high school education across the country, which means that the Chinese government is really clear that we will popularize the 12-year education. This is a very clear-cut requirement and arrangement. In addition, I believe that you are already aware that during the 13th Five-Year Plan, for preschooling education, the gross enrollment ratio will increase from 75% to 85% by 2020. If according to the standards of compulsory education adopted in China, We claimed the popularization of compulsory of 9-year compulsory in China at the beginning of this century because we adopted a standard of 85%. Also, one additional point. In terms of higher education, the gross enrollment ratio is 40%. By 2020, we intend to increase the figure to 50%. According to international practice, if this number is below 50%, we are still at the elite level, providing education only to elites. And if it is above 50%, we hold that it is at the popularization stage. During the 13th five-year plan, the compulsory education will be 9 years still, but our popularization will be elevated to a higher level. Second, free of charge. Now China has three free of charge items. The first is 9-year compulsory education. Second, the government work report and China's marketization reform state that we need to promote the free of charge education in vocational schools. To what extent for mid-level vocational training, figure has already reached 90% in terms of free of charge provision of educational services. Also, the plan and the government work report state that we should take the initiative to build registration systems for poor students and exempt their tuition fees. And this indicates that even though we promote a 9-year compulsory education in terms of free of charge provision of educational services, we will promote free education in a high school on a gradual basis. Also, in terms of media reports recently, some localities, in line with their respective circumstances, launch free educational services in high schools or even in preschooling institutions across the board. As an educational authority and government body, we are utterly supportive of this policy. And adopting such policies are mainly relatively poor regions. The reason, I believe, is that the leaders in these places, in these localities, are strategic in their thinking because they want to provide educational resources to these people, to these students, and via exemption of tuition fees, they want to lift the families of these students out of poverty and lay a very solid groundwork for their future career development. So tuition fee exemption is a critical element of improving the livelihoods of our population and also a critical measure in building a moderately prosperous society and lifting people out of poverty. So I would like to take this opportunity to thank government officials in localities who adopted this policy.
These two above-mentioned items are not part of compulsory education, but they are important measures about the popularization and free access for all in education. But the latter two points is more difficult. First, equity. That means the human resources and the educational level of different schools should be basically equal. It will be more difficult to achieve in preschool stage and high school stage. Why compulsory education after popularization still now face this kind of school district problem? That because That is because we have an imbalanced distribution for compulsory educational resources. If we incorporate all of those into all of the preschool and high school into compulsory education, it might become more difficult. Compulsory education means that you have to ensure equal access to education for all. Each family must send their kids to preschool as well as high school. And currently, the national condition simply does not allow us to do that. In the 13th five-year plan, therefore, we will still stick to the nine-year compulsory education scheme. But we will do everything we can to allow more people and students to receive better education. Thank you.
好，谢谢，请继续提问。中区，第六排边上第二位那个，不，那个女记者，女记者，她后边那个，后边，对。非常感谢，我是华尔街日报的记者陈德平，部长想问一下，你去年说西方价值观的教材不适合课堂，希望你可以解释一下，就具体解释一下，西方价值观在这个情况下就具体是指什么？ 因为马克思主义本身好像是西方的一个概念吧，然后另外想请教你，教育部有没有就是对这些有西方价值观的教材，就是如何处理的？谢谢啊。这个。With
Wall Street Journal, I have two questions. First is that last year it is said you said that textbooks.With Western values are not suitable for the classrooms. Can you please give us more explanations on what you mean by Western values? Because Marxism is also a kind of Western value. And another question is that how will the Ministry of Education approach those textbooks with Western values?
Thank you for raising this very good question. You know that Marx is not from China, but Marxism is the guiding ideology in China. I don't know if you are from the US, or I would guess because you are from Wall Street Journal. Do you believe in Marxism? The Chinese Communist Party is open.Because we start from our own standpoint and national conditions to determine what kind of guiding mindset we'll be using, and it has to be localized. It has to be adjusted to the national conditions, to Chinese conditions. So it's an innovation.According to Marxism, this is something that we will hold dear to. The values that we uphold is a combination of Marxism and Chinese traditional value. The Chinese government and the educational authority is trying to push forward.And advance the students' ethics education and moral education. But what you mean is actually the traditional sense of moral education. China has always attached great importance to moral education, including values mentioned by you. We have this great tradition of doing that.So ethics comes first in all forms of education. This is something that we've been holding up for many years. This is the principle for educational activities in school and outside of school. Ethic education always comes first. But how do we strengthen ethic education? For example, political education and moral education. I believe the Chinese government and educational authority mainly achieve this from through three paths. First, in content, we stress the aspiration and beliefs, and we stress the core values education and that of a traditional culture, and also the revolutionary culture with distinct Chinese characteristics. We've been always committed to this form of education so that our students can become you know, the socialist descendant, and they can be part of the builder of the socialist China. So these are the principles and guidelines for our education of all courses. And it should be incorporated in all educational activities in preschool, primary school, high school, and higher education. And we need to strengthen volunteer work and labor education so that the students can combine theories with practice and have a deeper understanding of our values and the outstanding Chinese traditional culture and the revolutionary culture. Third, as for function, we especially stress the importance of ethic education and morality education. And school education, family education, as well as social education need to come forward hand in hand. Therefore, the atmosphere in family, school, and the whole society, and also the ethic inside the party all have great influence on the students. We believe that the teacher's ethnic quality is also crucial, and so is that of the parents and those of the civil servants and celebrities, including you all. You journalists are also celebrities because you do a lot of reports and people would know you. So you are all moral standard of the whole society. Therefore, in Chinese education, we have to hold dear and continue to improve ethnic education. Last but not least, the young people in China have their aspiration and sense of responsibility and ambitions. They are fully capable and they should be able to achieve their dreams. And they will contribute their efforts to the prosperity of the nation and contribute to the entire humanity.
With Ta Kong Po, my question is about education in the rural areas in China.
I know that, Minister Yuan, you had years of experience working in the primary education sector. Now, as the Minister of Education, how do you see the problems in the education sector in the rural areas, and what kind of measures have been taken by the Ministry of Education to address them? And hypothetically, if the conditions back then were better than they were, will you choose to stay at the middle school you used to work in? Will you make that choice?
Thank you for the question. You've obviously done your research. I once was a teacher of a rural school. I worked in both public schools and private schools. You asked, what is my take on the current rural education situation? I really want to thank you for asking that question. As a journalist, you follow closely the Chinese government's efforts in improving rural education. This is obviously one of our gaps. The rural education in China is one of our gaps, as I said. To improve rural education rests upon the responsibility of the teachers. Over the years, the Chinese government has issued a lot of supporting policies. For example, free educational, and also Hekang project, and Boping education project. All of these projects are constantly improving the educational level in rural areas and the quality of the educational workers in rural areas. However, because of this difference between rural and urban area have been existing for many years, education also suffers from the same problem. Right now, we are going out to improve rural education. The key is to improve the quality of teaching resources in rural areas so that the rural teachers can stay where they are and they can teach well where they are. This is an important issue and has a lot to do with the salary and benefits of the rural teachers. Therefore, last year, the State Council issued the plan for supporting the rural teachers, which is a comprehensive deployment for the normal education in rural areas. And right now, we are striving very hard to implement what we have achieved, what we have listed in this document. First, to unify the salary level and the number of personnel of rural and urban area. In the past, we have a vast difference and gap in this regard. But right now, we are trying to make these two numbers closer to each other. That is the ratio of a teacher and students and the ratio between teacher and class.
Also, we need to expand the sources of rural teachers. and through multiple approaches, we should expand the sources and create more education resources in rural areas. Third, we should improve the compensation structure for rural teachers. A couple of years ago, in a wide range of impoverished areas, we already put in place arrangements and met with tens of thousands of rural teachers. This time around, we will provide allowances for the living standards of the rural teachers. Fourth, resources should be leaned towards rural teachers. Fifth, excellent teachers in urban areas should engage in rotating positions in rural areas as a requisite for their career path. In addition, we should strengthen the training for rural teachers to improve their professionalism and their ethical standards. Moreover, we will establish a honor system for rural teachers. Plus, we should popularize and promote relevant systems for the rural teachers so as to provide more channels of development and area of activities for the rural teachers. I've listed 8 items. Currently, as per requirements of the State Council, more than 30 provinces, municipalities in China have already launched implementation plans and promoting such plans. The Ministry of Education will meet with relevant government authorities to strengthen coordination and transfer payments for rural areas. Also, the Ministry will promote the implementation of preferential and supportive policies for rural teachers in different localities. We believe that through our concerted efforts and a period of time, we will be able to build a very good workforce in rural areas and improve the educational levels in such regions. You asked a very real question, actually. You asked about whether I would be willing to go back to the rural area.
I want
to share with you my Gaokao score was good, actually. The first school that I applied for was Beijing Normal University. It's because I was fully prepared that once I graduated, I would be willing to go back and continue to teach as a rural teacher. But then I was recommended as a student for graduate school, and I stayed where I went to school and served as president. So in general, this was not really my own decision, but rather the plan of the organization, the entity that I work for. But despite this, I have great attachments to rural areas, to rural teachers, and I hold them in awe for the sacrifices and the hardships they have to go through in such tough work environments. I'm deeply moved, and for China's rural teachers, I'm willing to do my utmost to do my work better. Thank you. Next question, please.
Uh, 谢谢主持人。香港中评社中评网记者提问。袁部长您好，我们知道去年这个 BBC 拍摄了一部纪录片哈，记录了这个中国老师在英国支教的这个场景，这也引发了大家对于这个中西教育的这个讨论和这个对比。那我想请问部长的是，您怎么看这个中西教育的这个异同呢？谢谢。
With China Review News, we know last year BBC aired a documentary about several Chinese teachers teaching in a British middle school, which sparked a lot of debates and discussions about the different styles of education in China and Western countries. What is your take on the similarities and differences between Chinese and Western education?
Thank you for your question.
看过 BBC 拍摄的
You did watch the documentary made by BBC. It was a three-episode documentary about the differences between Chinese and British education. It shows your interest in this issue. I want to say first that BBC wanted to release this documentary because in 2009 and 2013,Chinese students in Shanghai participated in an exam and evaluation conducted by OECD, and they won the first in the world for two times in a row. And such an achievement sparked interest from the international community in China's education.And generated their curiosity for China's educational system, particularly how did China organize their educational resources to be able to achieve such results. Also, it triggered public debates as to what differences and similarities there are between Chinese and British education styles. Let's refrain from commenting on the.The content of the documentary for a while and focus on the effect of such a documentary, which is it sparked public debates. China has many traditional elements related to education, and we have our own unique features and model. There are a lot of things to sum up if you ask an expert about this. But.From my perspective, Chinese education is focused on the dissemination of basic knowledge and the training of basic skills. It attaches great importance to the cultivation of habits and standards. In addition, with the hard work and the diligence of Chinese teachers and students, we were.Able to score a lot of achievements in a lot of areas, and we were able to have so many talents in the country. However, we do have our shortcomings. For example, our students, particularly primary and middle school students, suffer a huge workload at school.They have a lot of pressures of study. Also, Chinese students lack a capacity for innovation and for practical work. After the reform and opening up, and at the beginning of the 1990s, when we were promoting the so-called quality education in China, we discovered such shortcomings.So we emphasize that to promote quality education in China, the main goal is to strengthen the capacity for innovation and practical work. And in such areas, some Western countries can act as models in terms of their experiences.As we say in Chinese, that everyone has their advantages and disadvantages, pros and cons. So In China, we should continue to carry forward our virtues and traditions. Also, we should be humbled to draw from the experiences, the positive experiences and approaches, as well as practices of countries in terms of education, so as to improve China's education levels. And in this way, China can make greater contributions to global education. Next question,
please.
With Xinhua News Agency, my question is about the transformation of higher education institutions. Could you please give us more specific information about such transformation and what kind of institutions of higher education will undergo such transformation?
The transformation of Chinese universities in its very nature is actually a supply-side restructuring reform of China's educational sector. Since the new China was founded, particularly since the reform and opening up, China's higher education has been developing at a very rapid pace. I've said that we have reached a gross enrollment ratio of 40%. We have 500 higher educational institutions in China and more than 30 million university students, higher educational students in China. Some say that this outnumbers the second place by 10 million students. During our rapid development in the educational sector, while we achieved great results in economic and social development, and while we proceed with the economic and industrial restructuring, we found that China's higher education structure is not very sound, which is reflected in that we tend to cultivate theoretical and academic students, and we lag behind in educating skilled professionals and technical professionals, which is why people comment that Chinese universities tend to be very homogeneous, because we tend to educate academic students only. And such a structure coincides with China's economic and industrial structure. This results in one consequence, which is that on the one hand, university students find it difficult to find suitable positions. On the other hand, employers find it difficult to secure the right talents. This is what we call a structural conflict and mismatch. The solution to this is to optimize China's educational structure, achieve our own features and improve our quality, so as to meet the demand from economic and social development for educational resources and diversify our educational approaches in accordance with the demand of our general public. So we are facilitating the transformation of universities towards an application-oriented approach. We constantly say that we encourage regional universities to achieve such transformation, but we are not discriminating against regional universities. There are three tiers of universities in China. One is at the national level, the second is at the provincial level, and the fourth is at the regional level.
And right now, almost all localities have their own educational institutes. Therefore, those who belong to the ministry only amounts to about 100. Most of them are provincial level or municipal level. So in order to cater to the needs of popularization of higher education, we have to upgrade educational level of the local universities. They should be the pioneer in transformation of institute for higher learnings. In the past, they cultivate theory-oriented talents, but now they should cultivate more people with applied skills so as to better cater to the need of the enterprises and economic and social development at the local level. That is the goal of our transformation, and the approach to that is to set up applied disciplines. Sometimes it might be too costly, for example, for engineering and science. But if you want to set up an applied discipline for the humanities, it might be cost less. So there's a mismatch with the industrial structure of the whole country. This is the first priority, is to adjust the setting for disciplines. The core to transformation is to change the educational model for talent. The talents with applied skills is different from those who are cultivated in the theoretical, traditional theoretical education. They share some common grounds, but they are also different. Einstein is different from Einstein, and they cannot do the work for one another. But both of them made major contribution to the entire humanities. It's hard to tell who makes the greater contribution. Therefore, through transformation, we should be able to cultivate more talents that can meet the demand for the economic and social development, who can work at the front line and who are skillful enough to do professional and technical work. This is the key to our transformation. And the approach is through pilot projects and demonstration projects. So far, nationwide, according to central government's deployment, we have documents to promote the transformation of local universities, and this allocation comes from the central government. I believe that you sit in for the work report of the NPC by the top legislator, Mr. Zhang Dejiang, and a lot of work has been put into the drafting of this document. According to central deployment, as I said, more than 20 provinces and 200 schools are pushing forward the transformation pilot projects at the local level. It has already started. And the educational authorities will work with relevant agencies to press this ahead in first, strengthen guiding, and second, to give support, and third is to make conclusions and promote successful examples. Therefore, we give priority to the need of the people and the country so as to form a better structure for the higher education and to cultivate talent that will better suit the need of the people and the country. I believe that through our efforts, this cause will be pushed forward consistently so that higher learning can have the biggest scope in the world, as well as the best teaching quality and structure of the world. Of course, in the end, We need to cultivate the best talent in the world. These are the ultimate goals for us to push forward the transformation from the General Education Institute of Higher Learnings to a more applied education model.
2015年的9月份，国务院出台了关于深化考试招生制度改革的实施意见。在这个意见当中呢，就明确了从2015年开始要逐步的增加使用全国统一命题高考试卷的省份。那我想，包括我们在座的记者在内啊，大家如果家里没有考生的话，可能对这个政策变化之后产生的效果，感受不是特别的明显。那么在这儿呢，我们想请问您啊，您觉得在从15在2015年啊，新增的省份有哪些？那么今年呢，这个范围还会不会逐步的再扩大？有没有一个明晰的一个指向？另外呢，就是代表委员们呼吁的全国高考一张卷，您认为这个可以有吗？如果可以的话，距离我们有多远？谢谢。
With CCTV, we noticed that back in September 2014, the State Council issued opinions on deepening the reform of the enrollment and examination systems. And since 2015, we have seen an increase in the number of provinces that adopt uniform national tests for the college entrance examinations. For people that have no children that are going to take the test, they do not have a direct impression of the impact of this policy. So could you please give us more information regarding that, for example, in 2015, the number of new provinces that adopt these uniform national tests for the college entrance exam, and will this number increase this year? And by extension, I also have a further question. Do you think, is it possible that in the near future we can adopt this kind of uniform national tests across the whole country?
你提这个问题呢，我看到两会期间的。
I noticed that during the two sessions, a lot of deputies talked about this issue. And after the State Council disclosed this document, this has become a very heated topic. My opinion is that after the founding of the PRC, for a very long time, the whole nation adopted a uniform national test for the entrance exam. But this kind of situation changed about more than a decade ago.
为什么要改变？
Why?
当时主要是
at that time,
分省分阶段实施新的
the new system for entrance examination and the reform of the teaching system changed starting from some provinces and then extend this reform to other provinces and localities.
另外一个情况呢，因为十多年前
another situation is that more than a decade ago, we were promoting reform of primary education and high school education, and different regions have different progress in order to suit the progress and development level of different regions, and also in order to prevent this uniformed tests and its implied risks of confidentiality. This might be a lot of pressure. That is why starting from 2004, I believe all of you remember clearly that in that year, in 2004,
this
differentiated national test was adopted nationwide.
先后在16个省份
in 16 provinces
分省
we took the initiative
试点
to have different national tests
分省命题了那还有15个省份谁命题呢
as pilot projects but what about the rest of the country
the
The National Test Examination Center is responsible for making the test for the other for the rest of the country. So altogether, there are four tests, four set of tests. That is, in the past decades, each year we have about 20 different sets of tests in the country. This was originally aimed at suiting the different progress in the reform. But after running it for more than one decade, we found problems. Reform is mostly problem-oriented. But if new problem emerged,We will continue to make new reforms. So it's always a changing process. So one decade had passed. We found that in 16 provinces, the quality of the test is different and they vary. And after each year's entrance exam, people would compare the writing test and the, for example, different disciplines, the English test and math tests.